hold. Yeah. Oh,
oh, oh. I welcome you to this program. And I believe God with you that the Most High, the awesome and the almighty God, will prove himself in all of our lives and show himself strong and mighty in the name of Jesus. If Jesus could make glory a prayer point, his prayer point, then it says something to us. It is a crucial subject that each one of us must pray earnestly about and must connect with. If Jesus could ask the Father to glorify him, then you and I need to connect with the glory of the living God. We journey this evening in this program that has been tagged From Glory to Glory. And tonight I will be looking at the man or the person that will go from glory to glory. I take my anchor scriptures, or the reading that will be the central reading for this program, from 2 Corinthians chapter 3, and I read verse 18, and I'll also be reading 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9. 2 Corinthians 3, 18. It says, "But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord." We all, with open face, beholding as in a glass, as in a mirror, the glory of the Lord. And then by what we are beholding, we are changed. What we see bring change into our life, into the same image, from glory unto glory, even by the Spirit of the Lord. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9. "But as it is written, eyes have not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for them that love him." One of the things that is very difficult to define is glory, because it has several many manifestations, and it has many multifacets. Each time we talk about glory, we talk about the brightness of heavenly bodies over something, maybe on an object, that bring a shining, something that make a shine, that or that call for shining, the kind of brightness that builds the ordinary or the imaginations of men. For example, Apostle Paul was given an account of what he saw on his way to Damascus in Acts of the Apostles chapter 22 in verse 11. Acts of the Apostles chapter 22 verse 11. He said, "And when I could not see for the glory of that light," with me, he saw a light that blindfolded him. It was too much for the eyes to be able to contain. He called it light, but the light blindfolded him and he couldn't see for a season. And so he called it the glory of the light. So which means there is a glory of the light which is brighter than the eyes can accommodate. And whenever glory manifests, it suddenly brings manifestation. When it comes, when that kind of glory reflects upon the field, for example, it brings the kind of manifestation that goes beyond the description of any man. In human being, when we talk about glory, we talk about the external manifestation and condition that make people to shine. Something that comes, the support, the radiation of power, the grace that comes upon a man that makes everything about his life to, you know, to change and make him to shine. When you talk about Joseph, for example, Genesis chapter 45, verse 13, talk about his glory in the land of Egypt. That when his brothers saw him, they couldn't recognize him because there was a level of glory over his life that has transformed, translated, and changed who that man was. The psalmist in Psalm 21, when you read from verse 1 to 5, was talking about the glory of God upon King David. And he began to enumerate what that glory, what he produces, what it is. It brings about the kind of great manifestation and shining that brings turn around. Now, if I read Psalm 21 and read from verse 1, it said, "The king shall joy in thy strength, O Lord, and in thy salvation. How greatly shall he rejoice. Thou hast given him his heart desire, and hast not withholding the request of his lips. For thou preventest him with the blessing and goodness. You preservest him with the blessing and goodness. Thou setted a crown of pure gold on his head. He asked life of thee, and thou gavest it him. Thou lengthened of days forever and ever. His glory is great in thy salvation. Honor, majesty, and thou hast laid upon him." So when you talk about glory, you talk about everything that bring honor, that bring majesty upon the lives of a man. Amen? And so wherever the glory manifests, it bring, you know, shining. It makes the desires in the hearts of a man, you know, to come to pass. It make results very easy. It make something happen in the life of that person for the good. Something good to show for in the life of an individual. Proverbs chapter 20, verse 29, talk about glory in a different dimension. It said, "The strength of the youth is their glory." Or the glory of the youth is their strength. Now, which means, when you talk about glory, you talk about something that strengthens a man to excel in life. Something that gives a man the ability to excel. So going from glory to glory, is to excel in every facet and aspect of one's life. And so, as you excel in this phase, and people thought, "Oh, that is the only aspect of life that you know." In other aspects, every area of your life, the excellence, goodness of God will be there, and you continue to excel. And then in Jeremiah chapter 9, when you read from verse 23 to 24, verse 23 to 24, it talks about glory, and it puts some components into it. You know, and Proverbs 20:29. Now they have something, some similarity. Certain components were put into the glory. It has wisdom, it has might, and it has riches. Each time you talk about glory, it has the components of wisdom, it has components of might, and it has components of riches and knowledge. And wherever this thing is, everything that a man needed in life, is also manifest in a great and in a mighty dimension. So the one who will go from glory to glory will receive the divine brightness, and the countenance of God will shine upon such an individual. He receives a backing to excel, the wisdom to excel, the strength, the might to excel, the riches to excel, the knowledge to excel. Everything that gives a man the ability to excel will come upon such an individual. And I want to believe God with you this evening. Everything that it takes to excel is your portion. I say everything that it takes to excel, the impartation, the grace, the release is your portion today in the mighty name of Jesus. Because beginning from this moment, whether the devil likes it or not, in every area of your life, there will be a success story. In the mighty name of Jesus. If you believe it, let your amen be better. I will be concentrating this evening on the story in Luke chapter 15 from verse 11 to 20. Luke 15 from verse 11 to 20 is a very popular story that we know. The story is popularly called the story of the prodigal son. But I want to use different title for that man this evening as we look at his story, look at his life, and look at some pertinent lesson you learn from the life of people who want to go from glory to glory. And I call him the story of a determined son. As a matter of fact, when you read that story, you will discover that there were four characters in that story. He was one of them. And I think that story is more of a loving father than that of a prodigal son. You have primarily in that story the story of a loving father who have all things in abundance. A father who is abundance in mercy. A father who is abundance in goodness. A father who is abundance in resources. A father who have everything good at his disposal. And he can give liberally. You find in that story, a story of a young man who was determined and who was ready to break protocol. Now, even though most of the time when we talk about him, we talk about his failure. But when you read the story of that young man very well, you discover that it was not a failure. Though he has a setback, though he went down at a certain time in his life, but it cannot be called a failure. Because a failure is a man who failed and who never make any attempt to come back. A failure is the one who failed to make any attempt. A failure is the one who, in the process of making an attempt, allow himself or herself to be scared away by the heaviness or the challenge on the way. But for a man who met a setback, who survived his setback, and who came back, it was a determined son. And then you have the story of the enviable servant. Because the young man came to a place when he said, "How many of my father's servants are eating to their satisfaction? And I am dying of want," which means there are some servants that are enviable. There are some servants that are riding on horses where some princes are trekking. There are some servants who have what it takes to be in when some children are there outside. There are some servants who are eating to their satisfaction when some children are dying of want. There are enviable servants. My prayer for you this evening is that you will not be envying, you will not be envious of servants. It will be the servants that will be envious of you. In the mighty name of Jesus. And then number four character you find in that story is the jealous brother. In this world, we have jealous brothers who are not happy with the progress and with the blessing of their brothers, who are envious of what God is doing in the life of their brother. They are always bitter because of the progress in the life of their brother. But they are not the center of discussion this evening. But one thing you need to understand, in life, it is better to be envied than to be pitied. And there is always something that happens in the life of a man that makes others to envy him. My earnest prayer this evening and in the course of this program is that something that people will envy will come upon your life in Jesus' name. Something that people will covet will begin to manifest in your life. Nobody is envious of a madman on the street. When you see a man going through difficulty and traumas of life, you have nothing to envy in them. But when you see people who have all things comfortable and all the goodies of life, you make them a prayer reference. God, as you have honored so and so, as you have shown forth your glory in the life of so, let it be. Let it also happen in my own life. May I also pray for you one more time this evening. May you become a reference point that people will begin to use as a point of contact in prayers. May all things be well in your life. And may all things work well for you. In the mighty name of Jesus. If you believe it, let your amen be better. Now, in that story, Luke chapter 15, as you read from verse 11, and it said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of good that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his field to feed swine. And a wolf fain had filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father have bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger? And I will arise and go to my father, and I will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and I am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. Praise the Lord. Some beautiful lessons to be learned in the life of this young man. You know, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 11 says, everything that happened for our admonition, for our lesson. Every story, there is some pertinent lesson to be learned in them. And until you learn such lesson, you don't get what you're supposed to get. Now, you find some things strange in the life of this man that has some positive connotation for as many people who want to achieve, who want to get to the place of greatness in life. The first thing you discover about this man was that he made a choice. He made a choice for himself. It wasn't anybody who asked him, who said to him, go and meet your father. But he made a choice. He decided within him. He made a choice and decided. Now, each and every one of us is a product of decision. Where you are now is a choice that you have made. You decided to be here. You have a choice whether to be here or whether to be somewhere else. A number of things happen in your life that is a choice. That you have a choice whether you want to allow them or you whether to disallow them. Whether you want to go through them, whether you want to reject them. We go through choices every day. And one beautiful thing about the choice, about choices, is that they play a significant role about our life. Because the choices you make today determine who you become tomorrow. Where you are today is a choice you have made yesterday. And the choices you are making today will also determine where you will be tomorrow. The choice you don't make also, there are certain things that will make it for you. When there are choices to be made and you refuse to make a choice, because not making a choice is also a choice. When you fail to make a choice in life, time and situation force certain choices on you. Certain things happen that, you know, you did not make a choice, but time and situation bring a choice into your life, make things happen. Because the changing time, the changing circumstance, the changing situation make a man, you know, to face a situation on a daily basis, which way to go, what step to take, and what to do. And once you don't do what you're supposed to do, the situation of life overtakes such an individual and they will be behind. That's why 2 Corinthians chapter 6 verse 2, 2 Corinthians 6 2, make it very clear to us that now is the accepted time. Each time there is a choice to be made. Now, don't prolong it, because the choice you don't make today, it may be too late tomorrow. And so many choices to be made from, and so you must make. You need to make the most of your today so that you can get the best that God has to give you. You need to understand that until you lay claim on your right, you need to make a choice. It is a choice whether you want to lay claim on your rights or not. Claiming what belongs to you is a choice. And you can choose to forfeit it. You can choose to get it. You can choose to say, this is my right, I want to go after it. And you have a choice to say, well, I want to let it go. Obadiah, the only chapter in verse 17, says, the house of Jacob shall possess their possession. Even though that is the plan and the purpose of God, but each one of us has a choice whether you want to possess your possession or you want to allow somebody else to take it. But I want to say to you in the course of this program, everything that rightly belongs to you, you will possess your possession. You will get every of your entitlement. You will get all of your rights. It will come unto you. In the mighty name of Jesus. If you believe it, let your amen be better. You find out from the life of that man was he was such a risk taker, which is the second thing that is prominent in the life of anyone who will get from to glory and move from glory to glory. He was such a risk taker. It was very risky for a child to confront his father and say, Daddy, I don't want to wait until you die. Give me everything that belongs to me from your possession. I want it now, and I want it now. Now, there could be different ways the father would have responded unto that. But that young man took a risk. And I want to tell you Failure to take risk is a dangerous risk. Risk is something that divides between achievers and failure. You can't achieve anything in life if you are running away from taking a risk. There is nothing meaningful that a man can ever achieve in life if he's not willing, if he's not ready to take a risk. Until you are ready to risk your life for something, your life will not count for anything. But when you risk your life for something, it will count for so many things. There are a lot of things that people achieve in life. Sometimes when you look back and look at the step and the things you have done, sometimes you ask yourself, I don't even know how courageous, what gave me the courage to venture into it. But because it was the time of your glory and God has to manifest himself in your life, he will allow you to take step at the appropriate time, to take a worthy and a calculated risk at a time. One thing that separates Peter from the rest of the disciples was that he took a risk at a time in his life. In Matthew chapter 14, in verse 29, Peter looked at the master. He looked at the master, seeing him walking on water. All of them in the boat were afraid. But Jesus has said, "It is me, don't be afraid." Peter asked, he said, "If it is you, bid me to come." And there on the from the boat, Jesus said, "Come." He stepped out of the boat. Now, most of the time, what people remember was that Peter was doubting at a point and he began to sink. But you discover that Peter never sank. He was sinking. I don't know to what extent, whether to his ankle or whether to his knee, but he was still on the water. In the midst of all the disciples, it was the only one who has the story that he walked on water. How many steps? I may not know. But he walked on water. He did something that the rest of his colleague never do. Why? At the instant of the word of God, he acted. Most of the time, the word of God comes with definite instruction. But what determines those who will achieve and those who fail is how many people act on the word. It is not how much of the word that you hear that benefits you, but how much of the word that you act upon. But I tell you, it takes a risky mind to act on the word of God. Because the truth of the thing about the word of God is that most of the time, it does not comply with common sense. Most of the time, it does not comply with the principle of the worldly process. It has its own different process. How can you explain to a man who earns a salary and the 100% salary is not sufficient for him to spend, and you ask him to pay a tithe? A man who is complaining that his salary is not enough for him, talk less of the other responsibilities that he has. And yet you ask him to give an offering. It does not go with common sense. But it takes those who are ready to take a risk to say, "Well, if God said it, I will do it. Let me take God by his word." When you are taking calculated risk, you are taking God by his word. Do you know that it is a risk to go into a marriage? I don't know if you have ever imagined. You stand before the altar and they say, "Oh yeah, make a pledge. I will love you. Whether you are poor or you are rich." It's a risk. Whether you are in good health or in sickness, I will continue to be your husband. I will continue to be your wife. It's a risk. And I tell you, if you don't take that risk, you remain single. It takes only those who are willing to take a risk. I know that anything can happen, but I go for the good. I go for the good. And I know that I will see the goodness of God in the land of the living. Hallelujah. When you develop this mind, you will see great manifestation. When you take worthy risk, it will change your fortune for the better. Every worthy risk you take, change your fortune for the better. How will you talk about Ruth, married to one of the sons of Naomi? Now, by the calculation of Naomi, he said to the woman, when you read in Ruth chapter 1 and you read from verse 16, 15 to 16, he has said to the woman, look, I don't have any other son to give you. The one you married to is dead. Now, if you want to follow culture, I will give you any other boy that I have to marry you. But I don't have. So, and I don't even have an husband. For me to give you another husband, you must wait for me to marry, get a son, allow that son to grow up, and then you marry him. The process is very long. But the woman said, wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you lodge, I will lodge. Ask yourself, if your sister has taken the counsel from you that you want to go in that journey, what will your advice be? Go back. You don't have a future. But at the end of it, it proved human reasoning wrong. Why? Because she came out to become one of the aliens that enter into the genealogy of Jesus. You can't talk about the birth of Christ without talking about Ruth. She was one of the roots where Jesus sprang out from. Amen? So, risk is something that as many people who want to see glory must be ready to go through a risk. Have you read about the woman called Rahab, who decided to hide the spies and said to them, I know you are coming back to take this land because we have heard about your exploit and we know that God, your God, is going to give you the land. But I want to be spared. When you read about, again in Hebrews chapter 11 in verse 31, the Bible calls it a faith. Now, but it's a risk to have taken such a faith, to have, allowed those people, they are wanted by the nation, but he decided to accommodate them. Hallelujah. Somebody once said, the highest risk taker is the highest achiever. Each time people so and so person, we have one man in Nigeria who is among the richest people in the world. And I said, my response will always be, well, thank God for him, but I would have loved to be the one or to be one of my brothers. Now that man has a lesson to teach us why he take a risk to invest. The rest of us are just taking what belongs, what we have, and we don't think we need to invest. Risk taking leads to success and honor in life. The third thing you discover from the life of that young man that make his life enviable was that he was dissatisfied with his present. He looked at where he was and he said to himself, I don't think I'm satisfied with where I am. I need a change of position. I need to relocate from here. I don't think I am satisfied with who I am already is. I want to be better. Until you begin to desire to be better, you will remain the same. Until you begin to have dissatisfied with who you are today, you can't see, you can't be better than who you are. Thomas Edison said to us that dissatisfaction is the first necessity to progress. Dissatisfaction is the first necessity to progress. You want to make a progress in life, he said, you must first and foremost be dissatisfied with where you are, with what is, with what be. Why is it that car vehicle manufacturer and producers of things are getting us into buying things when we have one? They keep on improving on what they have. They dissatisfy with what they have now. They give you something, a better design. And when you have a better design, something has come into your life. Now, if people are designing their business, their products better, and it is attracting your attention, why don't you redesign your own business and do something better? What do you do? Think about what you are doing now and think of a better way of delivering results. Amen? The man called Stephen Covey, the man who is the writer of the 7 Habits of Highly Effective People, or the 8 Habits of Highly Effective People, said, there can't be significant breakthrough without first break with tradition. Before you have a breakthrough, he said, you must break with the tradition. And they call it paradigm shift. If you want something better, he said, there must be a paradigm shift. Break away from tradition. You cannot afford to do things the same way and expect a different result. When you desire a different result, you must do something in a different way. Amen. Paul in Philippians chapter 3, when you read from verse 12, after all his achievement, after all his attainment, he came to a point to say to himself, not as though I have already attained or have already perfect, but I press on, I move on, I push forward because I want something better. When you are satisfied with where you are, what will happen is that things begin to deteriorate. When you are satisfied with where you are, all the people behind you begin to catch up and begin to go ahead. If you don't want to make any progress, you must continue to walk. If you want to make progress, to maintain lead in life, you must always double your movement. Because that is the only way by which people can, others behind will not catch up with you. Until you are willing to leave your Goshen, you won't get to Canaan. There are many people who are satisfied with Goshen, but the plan of God for your life is to be in Canaan. Goshen is a temporary place. It's a transit land. Your permanent place of portion is in Canaan, and you must be ready to move on. If Daniel has not considered Jerusalem above Babylon, he will have died a slave. His life was comfortable in Babylon, but yet he was still going into fasting and praying for the restoration of Jerusalem so that it can be restored, so that the glory of God over his life can come back. May the glory of God over your life be restored in the name of Jesus. May you not die on transit. May you not die on the road. May you not die unaccomplished. In the mighty name of Jesus. You discover from the life of that man that he was a man of value. which is number four thing. He has value. He placed value on the right thing. What you value determines what you will pursue in life. What you value is what you will appreciate. And what you appreciate is what you will desire. And it is what you desire that will invariably becomes yours. What was the problem of Esau? He did not value his birthright. He valued food over his birthright. And that was the reason why that which is needed to sustain him in the future, he neglected today. And when the future came, it became sorrow. It was empty. Someone else has taken it. Someone else has filled it. Someone else has hijacked it from him. And the unfortunate thing is that when men call Jacob a thief, God never called him a thief. You can go through the pages of the Bible and read. You will never find in anywhere in the Bible where Jacob was reprimanded. No, he was not a thief. He was a negotiator who knew what he wanted and who bargained for it. Esau had a bad bargain. It was a bargain of inequality because the value of what he was changing or exchanging for his birthright was too low to be considered. But that was the value that they placed. What value do you place on education, young man? The value you place on education today will determine where you will be tomorrow. So when you find all your mates going to school, doing some extra studies, and you don't value it, you think they are wasting their time. When tomorrow comes, it will tell on you. And that is the reason why. If you are looking forward to a better tomorrow, study today. Increase your value of education and it will add value to your life. How much you value education will determine how much value your life worth. If a man goes to the workplace with a school certificate and the other person goes with his first degree and another goes into this market with a PhD, you are not going to be rated the same amount. The unfortunate thing is that age does not matter in this matter. They don't look at your age and say, because you are an old man and you only have primary six, we will give you more money. They don't look at you. It is your responsibility never matter. I remember a young man in one of our office, wrote a letter and he said, I need increment in salary because my responsibility has increased. And the HOD replied back and said, you are not paid according by your responsibility. You are paid by your qualification and your contribution. So it is not, well, a girl, I have six children. That is your cup of tea. What you have determines what you will earn. So value education and increase your worth. Education increase your worth. And so add it to yourself. And you'll discover that you will be up there. You will be up there. That young man value self-esteem. He value self-worth. He value self-control. He value free from any influence that want to stop his full potential. And he said to himself, Baba, I want to live now. It's a young man, when I wanted to marry, I was still living in the family house. and I wasn't contending the space with anyone. So when we decided to leave the place, they called a family meeting and asked me, why did you want to leave the family house? You are supposed to marry where you will be supervised. So that since you don't know how to run family, you will be where the eyes of everybody will see you and know how your family is being run. And I said to them, that is the exact reason why I want to leave. So that the way I run my family will be different from the way you run your family. If you don't value your family life, you discover that people will help you run it down. You can't be a married man and marry into the family house and everybody begin to, they turn your wife to the general wife. No, it's the wife of one person first and foremost and responsible to one man, not to the entire family. So this one will eat and finish eating and throw the dirty plate. Ask your wife to come and wash. When the cloth of somebody is dirty, they pass it to your wife to come and wash. And when they put the burden of the thing on you, the stress comes over you. Because the fact remains that once your wife is under stress, you are the first person who suffer. So the first thing every husband must learn to do is make sure you keep your wife out of stress if you want to enjoy your marriage. Amen. The number five thing I learned from the life of that man was that he acted boldly. He acted boldly. It wasn't any issue of before his father. He went to his father, stood before his father, and declared what he wanted to his father. He acted boldly. Look, this thing they call courage is the ability to press forward in the face of intimidation. It never mattered that his father, it doesn't mean that his father was a very gentleman. But courage makes a man to face the one that has an intimidating look and ask, make whatever demand you want to make. It takes boldness to claim your right in life. That's why in my place they say, the one who said, I don't want to die now, will never take what belongs to him in the family. Because you are not bold enough to ask questions. It takes boldness to ask. It takes boldness to communicate your conviction. It is one thing for a man to be convinced of God about sin. If you are not bold enough, you will not be able to communicate it. And if you can't communicate it, you can't get everything. I learned a pertinent lesson from the apostles in Acts of the Apostles chapter 4. When you read from verse 8 to 13, Acts of the Apostles chapter 4, from 8 to 13. Now, when the people were harassed, and when it seemed as if the whole world is against them, what was it that they did? They prayed for boldness. They did not pray for any other thing, but they asked boldly. Boldness. And the boldness they pray for guarantee every other thing they desire in life. There is a place that God wants to take each and every one to. But until you have this understanding, until you know it, that you must have the boldness and the courage to confront. Because whatever things that you don't have the boldness to confront, you cannot conquer in life. If there is something that God wants to give you, is that he wants to give you victory in every area of your life. Every aspect of life, in every aspect of life, people who rises in life always have something. And that is something that turned their lives around. And for everyone who have a turnaround in life, they always take a step. Let me round it up this evening by saying that young man also believe in himself before he could get what he wants in life. He believed in himself. Your success has nothing to do with what people say about you. But your success has so many things about how much of yourself you believe in. As a matter of fact, no man can succeed in life who does not believe in himself, who does not believe in his ability, who does not believe in what God can do through him. David was standing before King Saul. The king looked at him and said, young boy, you can't do it. You are too small. That man is a professional warrior. But David reordered the king and said to him, well, as for me, I know myself more than you know me. And I'm sure that God can walk through me. So the king discouraged him. He encouraged himself. 1 Samuel 17:33. He said to himself, I am able. Now, if the whole world tells you that you are not, you need to tell yourself you are able. When they tell you are going nowhere, you need to tell them you are going to places. When the whole world says you can't achieve anything, you can't be anything, you need to say to yourself again and again, I'm going to be great, I'm going to be mighty, I'm going to produce results. My life will count for something. And whatever it is that you allow your life to count for, it will begin to manifest in your life. What was the failure of the 10 spies? They never believed in themselves. Numbers chapter 13, as you read from verse 30, they said, when we saw the giants, we were like grasshoppers in our own eye. And so we were. Whatever conclusion you have about yourself, that is the conclusion that people will have about your life. And because they saw themselves as a grasshopper, they die like a grasshopper. In summary, Philippians chapter 3, verse 13, Philippians chapter 4, verse 13 says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can do all things through Christ who strengthened me. Meaning, three things. Number one, the spirit of possibility is in Christ. And when you are in Christ, you are connected to possibility. There is no way you can fail when the spirit of Christ lives in you, because that which makes Christ to be successful will make you succeed. Two, the desire for possibility is also anchored in Christ. I can do all things through Christ. If you are anchored and rooted in Christ, definitely and surely, there is nothing you desire that will not manifest. And then, every life that will experience glory must be committed to Christ. Because the beginning of the journey is who is actually supporting you. Now, because glory has something to do, it has some external influence into it. And when the influence of God comes over your life, everything changes for the better. And that is the reason why tonight I want to believe God with you. That where you have been walking all alone, where you have been surviving all alone, God will step into your matter. God will step into your situation. God will give you the empowerment. And beginning from this moment, your life will produce result. In every aspect of life where you desire a result, your life will produce a result. In the mighty name of Jesus. Now, the normal order that the life of order follow, and their journey in life is slow and sluggish, will not be your portion. What takes others 50 years to achieve, in the space of 5 years, God will give it unto you. God will make it available unto you. In the mighty name of Jesus. The genes that stop others from reaching their goal will not stop you. Because the backing of the Almighty God will be behind you. And it will give you the push that is needed to where you want to reach in life. In the mighty name of Jesus. The mighty presence of the Lord that led the children of Israel through the wilderness of life, so that in their wilderness they never experienced darkness. God was before them as a pillar of light, giving them illumination and direction. I say to somebody here today, beginning from this moment, every day of your life will have direction. Your life will have illumination. Where others are confused, where others miss their step, the power of the living God will order your step, will direct you, will guide you, will manifest over your life. In the mighty name of Jesus. If you believe it, let your amen be better.